I am unashamed. What about you?
You know, I thought our Zach did pretty good.
Well, I'm wondering though. So I take a week off. I was fleeing the hurricane, and then we had some family members get COVID. So I took off. Zach came in. I mean, it's just like the whole world went to pot. The podcast had to move to town.
Oh, it's a hurricane.
I mean, now I'm fumigating my house from the COVID. I mean, it's just, what's going on?
While you were at the beach or whatever, an event. We had a hurricane come through.
There was an event, but there was some beach.
Some disruption that happened.
But Zach did okay? He handled my
Well, chair. It got a little weird because when we started doing the ads, he went into the color commentator. It was like he started fluctuating his voice. And I thought, I got to tell him this. And so
I just told him, I said, you might ought to turn the intensity level down a couple notches.
So he was the guy selling the thing that goes on the boat, that goes out in the glass boat. He kind of became that guy.
He didn't know he was doing it.
I
guess his subconscious. And so I told him in front of everybody, I think. I don't know.
Did you tell him on the podcast?
Yeah, I don't know if they
He was
cut
sounding
it or,
like the guy who wants you to buy the stop leaks of all kinds, fish tanks, roofs,
Oh, that commercial's awesome. I mean,
it
sounds just like it.
When he said, who would make a boat out of glass, or no one would make a boat out of glass, but I would. I would buy that stuff just because I could.
That was the zone Zach was in, zone right there. Yeah. And I'm like,
tone
her down.
Y'all had to bring him back.
Tone her down a little bit.
I just mentioned it, and he kind of turned red, and he was awesome. After he quit doing all that, modulating his voice. So I don't think he knew he was doing it. But look, if I got a clerk, lay it on me.
Well, Zach
used
to... It
made you sound smooth indeed.
What can you say about that? But Zach called me after that first day. I said, how'd it go? He said, I appreciate what you do a lot more. Yeah. I said, good. Maybe that'll work well.
I mean, when you're family, I think it's better. I mean, it goes back to what Phil used to tell in the cooking world. If something is weird or bothering you, or like in food, it's not good, it's best just to bring it up. Whatever happens.
Everything needs to be, from time to time, critiqued, especially food.
Yeah.
Because if it's no good and you're faking it and you're saying this is delicious when you barely can swallow it, what you're ensuring yourself, if you brag on it, is bad cooking from that day on. Because they think, he loves it.
That's right.
We've got to fix it like that again. So don't let it slide when it comes to cooking. You say, we can't eat it. Second line of defense, we'll see if the dogs will, and we'll put it outside. If the dogs, they run from it. I said, don't cook it like that anymore.
Phil goes through this about every 10 days.
If you and the dog say, uh-uh.
So we do at our marriage retreat, there's one of the questions in the newlywed game, and it says, what's something your husband, tells you is great, but he really doesn't like? That's one of those questions for the thing. And I've always been amazed out of everything, that would be the one that's truly shocking to her, because he'll say his answer, and she's like, I thought you love that. I mean, you told me, and he's like, and then everybody starts laughing, but it's just what you said. I mean, it's like, she's convinced it's good.
Yeah, I'm on the other end. Some things I should just let slide, but I just can't help it. I have to bring it up.
Let 10 people cook the same roast, same cut. Put it out there. Everybody's got their own way of fixing it.
Mm-hmm.
All 10 sit around, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, number 10. They're all sitting around. They try everybody's recipe. They say, number 5. Well, they'll go around the thing. And if 7 out of 10 says number 5, that's the way you cook that.
Cook it that way.
They critique it.
Yeah.
It's not a question of,
nobody's
my feelings are hurt
nobody's
because
calling.
That's better. You're just critiquing it, and you're saying, this is really good. Well, they vote for it. Well, that way they end up being better chefs, because there's
well, every cooking show, competition show, which there's tons of them out there, is built on that exact thing.
That's exactly right.
And they're
right.
pretty brutal.
You ought to bring that down to the family level and let your wife know. Look, sometimes,
well,
honey,
I learned the hard.
Be bold.
I've blown it on many recipes. I mean, you
we're
know,
honest.
I first started making the jambalaya, and the first two or three out the door they went. I said, no.
Did the dog?
I ran up on that old boy from New Orleans. I ran up on his recipe, and I said, let me just try this old guy from New Orleans. Yeah.
But who would have thought? Besh. Who would have thought to put mustard and flour on a crappie? Now, I would have slapped somebody for even having that idea.
Yeah,
I like mustard. Okay, I guess. But
and a lot of mustard goes in there when you're doing.
Oh, I've seen people look at it and they're like, I don't want to eat that. Yeah. I'm like, trust me. Once you taste.
I had
this.
One the other night. He said, "Cause that's just solid." Whoa! I was just. And they said, "Do these taste like? Can you taste the mustard in them?" Because he was thinking, "This thing gonna over."
You just ruined it.
I said, "Not really." I said, "It just makes a nice batter, but it's not like a intense mustard flavor." Of course, he nailed about the sixth crappie, I'd be like, yeah, he's all right.
Yeah.
The approval test.
You can tell
test.
Whether something's good or not when you look up there and the plate is empty.
Well, they brought some guy we played cards with over to eat deer because he didn't like deer. And, of course, he'd never had my deer.
I was going to say, he hadn't had the right deer.
My deer, he only weighed, he's a little fella when I started the process, which makes better deer. But he was watching me prepare it, and he was just shaking his head like, no. He's like, no, that's way too much pepper. Because I was hammering that pepper. And he's like, whoa, I can't eat that. I mean, he just didn't want to eat it anyway. And then he watched me and was griping the whole way, saying, nope. So he got a little piece of it when they're eating it. I could tell he thought it was going to be bad. But he ate it, and he's like, that's the best thing I've ever eaten in my life. Well, and then he just got like a quarter of the platter. I'm like, what happened to this? I don't like pepper or what you do, buttermilk. You know.
Tony, my long lost daughter's husband, he had it right. He said, I've been eating y'all's cooking for the last few months. And he said, I'm here to give you some information. I will never cook for you people. He said, I'm out.
He knows.
I've just tasted your cooking, and I know what I can do. I'm out.
Which Eastwood said, a man's got to know his limitations, right?
That's it.
Dirty Harry. Yeah. Well, so we got Jep in the house from Austin.
What's up?
Welcome back to the Unashamed. We moved to the lair since the last time you were here. We moved out all the bunk beds.
Yeah, it looks awesome in here.
It's pretty good. How's
your orphan work you doing?
It's doing awesome. Yep. It is doing awesome.
And you brought a guest.
Yes.
Introduced
I brought
guest.
Rhett Walker.
Hey, hey.
Who Happy has an amazing Welcome, album out right now. It's my favorite. I
so, Rhett, you're a singer?
Again. I'm a singer, songwriter.
Well, you know.
Yeah, but I'm kind of afraid to talk on the mic now because I don't want to change my voice to sound like the Flex Seal.
Well, I was looking at you, and
I've got a new record out, and you
singer songwriter.
Rhett's the only one that remembered it was Flex Seal. Yeah.
Yes, I couldn't think of that.
I couldn't either. The guy with the boat.
I kept seeing the chickens, which I never figured that out on that commercial. They're like, there's some chickens, and he takes the wire down.
Flex Seal on the chickens.
Well, I think he. he took the wire off of a chicken cage, and then he put the Flex Seal on the wire and built a boat. But my point was, why did you actually have the chickens in the cage? I mean, did somebody say, I think it'd look better if you had the chickens in the cage?
People will believe it.
Looked like he'd have just got the wire.
I'm like, what is the chicken thing about? But then at the end, when he's riding through the boat, because he made one out of glass, he made one out of chicken wire, and he's riding. Then there's like, the camera pans over, and there's like a chicken on the back.
I haven't seen this
it's
chicken.
It's the cheesiest thing you've ever seen, but you know what?
It sold.
It's entertaining.
Well, you remember the guy, the guy that was before this guy died, Billy something. He was the guy with the beard. I mean, he had been on all those same commercials.
What, the same kind of stuff?
Yeah. The same products and almost every infomercial. And then
they all copy his particular.
That's exactly right.
Well, the tree fell on my roof. I'm up there. I'm great at destroying things. Terrible at fixing. We've documented that.
By the way, is the center block still under the dishwasher in your kitchen?
The center blocks are still.
So Missy just gave up. She let it ride.
What I've learned about the female race,
which she did move to
is
Austin,
that even though it might be bumpy, if it looks, I mean, somebody comes in and there's some cinder blocks, because I'm proud of it. I'm like, I fixed that dishwasher with two cinder blocks. I mean, MacGyver made 100 episodes doing this kind of garbage. And I'm sitting there, I finally fixed something, and she doesn't like the way it looks. I'm like, put you a little, what do they call those little garter, you know, you could put it like a little curtain. I mean, I said that. I said, put a little curtain on the bottom of it. You like it kind of stuff.
Out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah. So anyway, that's fixed. But what I've learned is functionality wins out in the end. The dishwasher would not work. It was a balance issue. After I tore it up, I fixed it with the center block. And then she finally just got over it, and she uses the dishwasher. But on the roof, I thought of that commercial, which, you know, they need to sponsor the show. I guess as much airtime. But I thought, I don't know how to fix this. I have a hole in my roof. So I called. I figured Jay would know. Jay said, I don't know. Call a redneck. I said, that's why I called you.
Maybe we can use that. So Cole, our technician, was telling us when he first came in to set up here, he and the guys, to put all our equipment stuff in here, he goes in, there's a closet over here off camera, and he's going in there to get some stuff, and there's a big, huge rat snake in that closet right there.
Nope.
And just, you know, and so then they're trying to, we got to get him in a bucket, get him out of here, because there's a hole over there where they're coming through, because I'm sure there's plenty of rats in this structure, because out in the middle of nowhere. So it was like, what other podcast studio? I wonder if Joe Rogan, when he just got his new studio down in Texas, I wonder if he had a rat snake
issue. Yeah, clear the snakes out before you
That's
get
exactly
here.
Right. Only on the Unashamed podcast.
We're in the woods. Look, I'm telling you, I was looking at that roof thinking what I was going to do, and a guy, my neighbor, literally was driving by and just saw me standing there, and he rolled down his window. I was looking. He said, you need some help? I said, yep. And so he come down there, but I didn't know he's like a contractor or whatever. That's what he does. He took a little roll of, looked like aluminum, and he just cut a couple sheets, and everywhere there's a hole, he pop, 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 caulked his little holes, you know. I was like, great. I was like, can I take credit for this? He's like, sure.
Oh, is this from where the tree fell in your house?
Yeah. I mean, I didn't fix it. Because he's like, that'll work. Because I thought, well, he fixed the roof. Because I thought functionality, I don't care if there's two silver plates up where there were some shingles.
No, you need to have backup on
yeah,
that.
Yeah, he said, no, it's a temporary thing. I was like, oh. Because I just.
But we flex sealed it. So it's stuck. It's
yeah, if you
hold on to your pocketbook, Jase, the roofing job.
And I'm like, so this won't work? He's like, well, it'll work in temporary. And I was like, I was like, I don't care what it looks like now. He said, yeah, but your wife will, which is what
back
I'm
to
coming
the
back to that.
Discussion.
I said, no, I think we've passed that. We've, as long as she doesn't walk on this side of the house, which she really doesn't.
But I'd
anyway.
Be shocked if you have that much. You're not going to have a new roof anyway. If you
I'm
had a
sure
new
will.
Roof since
Do you
got
know
that?
When they had to put their last roofing job on it?
Have you had a roof since you moved
that
in?
That doesn't matter. I mean, there was a hole, which I realized when I took the limb out of the roof, because I was up there, you know, with the blower.
Oh, it matters how
and I'm
old
like, how
is the roof.
I have no idea.
Yeah, well, if it's the original roof.
I'm not a home improvement guy. I don't. It looks okay.
Yeah. Well,
and I identify
when water begins to drip inside in places. You
no,
know
it can not. Drip inside. I was raised with a family structure, and if the water was not dripping and falling on you, it's good. the roof leaked in places, but as long as it was not over you,
you good.
You could if you couldn't move out of the way. Well, then you.
Well, I'll tell
went
you
up
this.
And see if you could fix it.
I've got kind of a dual citizenship going in Texas. It's a long story. That's why I'm visiting Jep all the time. I have a brand new house. Now, I'm not going to be there long because it's just
temporary.
It's a temporary thing.
It's like your roof
This
patch.
Thing was just built. And it rains. I hear, boop, bloop, 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 bloop. When I look, there's just water coming down out of one of the light fixtures.
Uh-oh.
I mean, it's been built. 2 weeks?
Yeah.
Oh, finished?
Lord. Always a bad sign.
Yeah.
That's what I thought.
Somebody missed something. Hang on, let's take a quick break. So one of our long-term sponsors here on the Unashamed podcast has been our good friends at Keeps redneck.com, and they're wanting to try to help people keep their hair, which is important. So, Dad, I've noticed. Do you notice a little more in the bottom of the shower at this point?
Not really.
Jase, you got a hairball in there a time or two.
Yeah, I mean, your hair, you get old.
Mine's definitely falling out. I tell mine every time I dry it off. But so we know it's a problem. And Keeps, basically what they do is they try to want you to catch it early before you lose it all. They don't bring it back, but they can help you keep more of it. So they've got a FDA-approved hair loss treatment, which basically offers generic versions of the meds that they have at half the cost, which is really good because this hair stuff is really expensive. They'll also ship it right to your door. You can order it online, which is great. You don't have to go to the doctor. You don't have to go, you know, some other place or the drugstore. So anyway, I want you to check these guys out. Keeps, K-E-E-P-S, keeps.com/door. You get 50% off your first order, which is really great. So it's keeps.com/door and keep your hair.
So Missy called the people who built it because, you know, we're talking, it's still under whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And he was like, yeah, it's, you know, there's a storm today. Nobody's working, you know. And so she was telling me this. I was like, no. You need to call that guy back. If you build a house and it's brand new and it's immediately leaking, you say, hey, get somebody over here. So she did. And they, you know, they came. It's like, oh. And the guy who came over, he's like, yep, bad roofing.
Uh-oh.
I was like, you think? So he's like, oh, I fixed it, you know. But I was like, long term or temporary? He's like, temporary. So I thought, well, I've got two houses, and both of them, the roofs are leaking. So you asked me how old it was. I got one that's 2 weeks old, and it's leaking worse than the one that had a tree in it. So if I had to do it over again, I shouldn't have taken the tree limb out. It's kind of like, you know, it's like these movies, somebody gets stabbed. You're okay as long as it's still in there. But once you take it out, you've got to get that fixed immediately.
Yeah. So Jep, back to Rhett here. Where'd you run up on Rhett?
We met years ago through, how did we meet?
Bill, you know Rhett. You've met this
He's
man
been on
before.
Duck Dynasty.
He was on an episode of Duck Dynasty.
So which one was that?
Him and you and Reed.
Yeah, it was the one where Reed did the CD release show.
That's right.
So
that's
we came down. Me and Mac Powell.
Yeah.
So you're a singer, you're a gospel singer, country singer, what?
Gospel singer. And I think it was right after I got signed in 2011 and put out a first record, and somehow we connected. I don't know how it was, but I sent like a gift bag to y'all, some shirts, CDs, all that stuff, and then all of a sudden I got some Duck Dynasty stuff, and I was like, this is awesome.
Yeah. We were exchanging.
We call that quid pro quo.
Yeah. So has the pandemic affected that particular lifestyle? I mean, it looks like to me. I mean, can you get people?
Yeah.
It's been.
You can't draw a crowd. I don't think. Maybe.
It's been a year for sure. So we played two full band shows that they socially distanced, and which was, I know you got to do it, but it was weird. Because everybody's just so far back, and
same with preaching,
and you put all this like effort into these songs to sing about truth and grace and like kind of connect with people, and there's no connection. It kind of feels weird, but my wife was happy, because I'd been home. She homeschools, and I'd been home since the top of the year. We played one show, March 15th, and they're like, we're shutting it down.
We need to hear about old Rhett. Let him play a tune.
Yeah, we're going to.
When I heard. You had a song that I have on my playlist. Now I've forgotten the exact name, but it's something about Come to the River.
That's it. That's the name. Nailed it.
Come to the River. Yeah.
Something
I was
like
trying
that.
To get the tune in my head. But because I've always felt like Phil's in the middle of nowhere down here.
By the way, there are a lot of individuals. I reckon it's this podcast. I'm not sure. But let's talk about coming to the river. In the last 2 or 3 weeks, I mean, it's been well over 100 people who have come to be baptized where I was up there, because you got Willie and you, Jase, you, Al, Owens is over there.
You went different locations.
Different locations. But they're coming. I just noticed, I looked down and they were giving me their names and addresses, and some of them I was just asking, where are you from? And but they said, well, we come all the way down here. They basically came from about 10 different states.
Wow.
And gathered up, and the women went out on one side and the men on the other, you know, getting in some old clothes and whatever. Mm-hmm. And we were just, it was a happening.
Yeah, most of it is you guys, it's the Unashamed audience. I mean, obviously it's impacting. I think
the best two I saw were two women. One was like 25, and I said, who's that with you? And she said, she was standing on the stair. They were coming down in to the baptistry. And she said, I came here. We came here, Mom and I, from New York City. I said, New York City?
I said, well,
y'all look perfectly normal. She said, well, the truth is, I've been an atheist all my life, Mr. Robertson. And this was the daughter. She said, I've been an atheist all my life. She said, I would be called a left-wing liberal from way back. And she said, I got to listen to you guys, whatever, read one of your books. And she said, I just looked and I thought, she said, what in the world am I doing? If this, with immortality's looking at me in the face, and I'm sitting here, you know, just rocking through life, and, you know, rioting or whatever, get out in there, march with them and all the Black Lives Matter and all that. I said, well, tell you, your brothers and sisters are all sitting out here now. I said, you're fixing to be added to the kingdom of God. I said, tell them your stories. And she did. She said, I came all the way down here, and her mom was with her. I baptized both of them, but it was a cool, cool thing.
Well, how did that song? I know you have a new album, but how did that song come about? To come to the river, because it just it fits here. I mean, we share Jesus. People, you know, they come down here, they hear about Jesus. We have a river, and that's just what we do. You know,
there was one guy came down day before yesterday. Owens called me. And they said, we have this guy, he's a paraplegic, he's paralyzed from his waist down, been that way for a while, and he wants us to baptize him. What do you think? I said, bring him on down here, we'll figure it out. So he went down there in his wheelchair, but they had another one that was a little bit better suited for water, kind of a scaled-down version. We got him and put him out of the one wheelchair and put him in the other one, turned it around backwards, and I got three of the status ones we had around there, and we just rolled it down where we launch our boats and got in there. And the water.
It's a new song idea, Roll to the River.
Yeah, the water was coming up deeper on him all the time. Mm-hmm. And I told those guys, I said, guys, just right off the end of this boat ramp, it drops off to about 12 feet, so if this thing gets away from us, I said, this is going to be baptism.
Like that. He wasn't baptized. Awesome, he was launched. Yeah. I mean, we should use that anyway.
We turned the wheelchair, like, you know, we just turned it over with him in it, and I said, trust us, man. We've got you. Don't worry
about
it.
That's awesome. That's pretty cool. That is awesome.
And down he goes, wheelchair and him. And we got up. Well, then the trick was, you know, steep boat ramp there. I mean, you
got to get him back up.
Now, you know, that really highlights, though, what you're doing, because we know it's about Jesus saving you, but you're surrendering and you're trusting. Mm-hmm. And in that case, you really see it. Because
he could literally become the watery grave. I mean, you know.
I mean, nothing personal. By the way, for all the paraplegics, if I saw a man like you and I'm confined to a wheelchair and I'm like, trust me, it'll be okay.
I reminded him, I said, always remember this, my man. I said, at the resurrection, I said, we all going to die. I said, you and all of the rest of us. I said, but at the resurrection, I said, you will be equipped
whole
with another body. Right, and I said, you'll be able to jump and jump and
did he know
run?
You didn't have a bicep, that you were a unicep? You were out there trying.
Well, he had three other people.
Oh, okay.
I want to hear how that song came about.
So, so I moved to Nashville 2010, 2009. And so,
is it like a madhouse when you go
into a madhouse in Nashville?
I sense that, but
we moved
know
out of there. We're back in South Carolina now. I was there as long as I needed to.
Yeah. It's kind of like people that are actors. They move out to Hollywood and they're like,
you
got to
do the
here.
Thing.
Right, so you're just jockeying for a position?
So I'll back up, just kind of set the story up. Me and my wife, we got married 16 years ago. I was 17. She was 18.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Got pregnant.
You fit right in with us.
It was, I'm a pastor's kid, small town USA, erupted, you know, when they found out I got my girlfriend pregnant. And yeah. they were telling my dad, how can you, you know, run a church if you can't even raise your family? Yeah. Like he had anything to do with it. Yeah. And so, you know, we were kind of focused on ourselves. And I was like, man, we're messing up literally everything we do. We're trying to make this hard. So I was like, if we're going to make it through life, we got to keep our eyes on Jesus. I know it sounds cliche, but we surrendered our lives, we surrendered our marriage, and we surrendered that kid. And so now we got four kids in 16 years. But we moved to Nashville, man, on a dream. Like, she's the smart one. So she had a – she was going to, you know –
So you married not only an older woman, but
– Yep.
But one,
a wiser.
You married up.
A wiser, yeah. for sure. And she was going to school to be a doctor. And so she was like, man, I don't want to do this. I want to stay home with the baby. And I was like, you know what? That's fine. Because music is going to take care of it. Thank the Lord that it worked out. Because she might have killed me.
That sounds similar to a story that had a, you know, fishing is going to give us, you know, our way.
I mean,
to start.
I'm going to sell millions of these.
It turned out to work. Let's take another quick break. So one of the things we've noticed about the coronavirus, it has pushed a lot of people indoors and online. That's how people are doing all their business now. You hear people talk about Zoom meetings.
I'm tied up with it all the time.
Hey, but you really have done a lot of Zoom interviews, have you not?
It's the same thing.
I mean, you've been on the internet
look,
this time more than any other.
If you're doing it or you're telling the person who works for you to, hey, get online and look that up, you're still doing the same process.
Exactly.
You just have a middleman.
So what happens is, like with anything else, when you have something good, which in this case, helping people connect, do business, all that's good, you're going to have some bad come in. And so that's where our friends at ExpressVPN are going to be able to help you, because they love to steal your data. They love to know where you're going on your – every time you go search, they're putting these pop-up ads all over the place. ExpressVPN helps you protect, puts those walls up for you. So you want to check these guys out. ExpressVPN.com/Phil. ExpressVPN.com/Phil. You're going to get 3 months free. Get to try this out and see how much it can help you. We recommend it. So obviously,
how long, we moved to Nashville, and you know, I was writing these songs. I read a song called "When Mercy Found Me," and I started writing this song "Come to the River," but it happened with. We'd been there for a year, almost two, just trying to, you got to meet everybody. You're trying to do this, trying to like put your name out there and do all that. Man, it just, things were tough. You know, we were young with, I think we had our two kids. We were about to have a third kid then. And so I was getting kind of frustrated and trying to figure out life. And so I told my wife, this is what I do when I feel like I got to get alone. I just jumped in the truck and it was me and God time. And so driving down the road, complaining, yelling, whining, and I just feel like God was kind of listening, letting that moment happen.
You have to be careful when you perform, because you know the seems like the best looking chicks get down on that front part.
I don't think so much at Christian.
Maybe.
Well, what I'm saying is,
you just, me and my guys in the band, we take care of each other. We don't let anything slide at all. My dad always said, "There's no few minutes worth ruining everything you've worked hard for." Mm-hmm. So I'm going on 16 years and ain't nothing stopped. And also, my wife is
my wife's
beautiful.
I hope that works out well for you.
Yeah, well, that's why we got four kids, because she's beautiful. But, man, I took a right, and I ended up at a boat dock, like just right on the river. And so I started thinking, if I'd have drove any further, I'd drove into the water. And I was like, God, what are you trying to show me here? And I thought back to, you know, if we can thirst for everything, we can chase after everything, but there's one everlasting water that quenches all that thirst, and it's Jesus.
Yeah.
And so I was like, you know what? I give this to you. And a redneck from South Carolina, like, I'm a kick-the-door-in kind of guy. That's really, really hard to be like.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can't do it being lazy.
Right.
But it's like, God, if this is going to work just like everything else in my life, I'm going to mess it up if I keep focusing on me. Yeah. So you got it.
Just be patient, man. Be patient.
See, I like that song even more now.
Yeah.
That's I love hearing songwriters explain.
So you had heard this song before?
Have I heard it? It's on my playlist.
hears it regularly.
Yeah, it made the cut in my playlist.
I guess I might have to get off of Bad Company and Creedence Clearwater Revival.
This
start hearing some real jive around here.
He has a CCR feel to his music. I mean, that's I think what makes you unique, you know? Yeah. I mean,
I'm still there locked in there. I heard it through the grapevine.
Well, I've tried to tell you, sometimes when you put in, you know, songs about Jesus that are creatively done, he can play.
Oh,
I don't want to classify your music, but it has a little Southern rock feel to it.
I don't think I could get away from it. My dad, it was Skinner.
Do you come from a music family?
Oh yeah, my dad he sings. He used to sing quartets, and my sister she's the singer. Like she, I mean, my gosh,
have you thought about teaming up with her? I mean, you know, like
no, who was it? This will take the limelight.
Young guy, and his sister, they in the 60s.
The Carpenters. Yeah.
No, because then she'll take the limelight. It'll be about her. I need my career.
You need your vibe.
So he's kind of being. I mean, it's like Scottie Pippen saying, "Now Jordan, he's the real player.
You're doing pretty good yourself there, buddy." But no, I mean, God's been good. We've been traveling on and off, and my first single got nominated for a Grammy, and it was
really
we went and we didn't slow down, and so until now, till 2020, and like I said, I think I bought more bread and milk than I ever have. My wife when she's homeschooling, she's like, "You got to go somewhere," because if I want a snack, kids want a snack. I mess up her whole vibe.
I think as soon as this vaccine comes up, Trump gets that all lined out. Maybe a few months into 2021, I'm sure hoping and praying he wins. But with the vaccine and all things in the music industry anywhere else, I think it's
we hope so. I was reading something recently that said they weren't even really planning any like the music festivals or anything until at earliest late 2021. Is it even a possibility? So I think it's going to take a couple of years really for the whole industry.
Yeah.
Because, you know, all this uncertainty.
But you say that, and then there are pockets of people. I mean, like the event I did that I talked about, they just said to heck with it. We're doing it. There wasn't no 6 feet apart. And nobody had a mask on, and I didn't get the coronavirus, so I was fine. But even when I was in Austin this weekend with Jep, I did I like the idea of a mask when I'm doing something that I would deem yuppie-fied, because my wife's just like, "Look, we want to go downtown and ride Segways and just see downtown." I'm like, "Good, y'all take off." She's like, "No, we want you to come with us."
Ooh.
And, you know, you remember the Segway. Jep, was you in on that in Hawaii?
In Hawaii,
it was a Duck Dynasty episode. Everyone got hurt. I have a scar on my right shin.
I got hurt.
Because nobody told us how to use them. Because they wanted us.
Well, they wanted you to.
Yeah,
get
they wanted Si took off, bam, bounced off the ground about three times. I said, "Hey." I mean, I thought bone in his body
was just
broken.
What's that first step, boys? It's a doozy.
Willie fell off. And so I just, all that came to the forefront of my mind. She's like, "Anybody can do this." And she's like, "We all go down there and they watch the bats at dark, you know, take off. It's like a tradition." Have you done this?
Never done it. I've seen them lined up there. I'm like, "No."
Well, I did.
Bats.
So I go, because I thought, I have a mask on.
Every bat movie I ever saw turned out badly for them.
I thought, I have a mask on, so nobody would know it's me. So we go. Look, I get the little helmet on. Yeah, I put it on backward first, which was kind of funny. Ha ha. I get on the Segway, and I was the most shaky one, because this thing, you know, you drive it with your feet, where your feet are. You have a handle that you can just turn, but you don't. You don't lean back. You know, if you lean back, I mean, it's trouble starts. You have to keep your shoulders square. So anyway, I got used to it. We all take off. Everything's fine. We go down here. There's, I would say, 2,000 people under this bridge. And because there's nowhere to go. You get 2,000 people.
Yeah.
They're everywhere. And I'm like, now most people had a mask on, but still, I'm like, things go through masks. I mean, if you're just in a mass of people, but everybody seems
air's going through there.
All right. So I'm like, you know. Of course, you know what's sad? the bats, about right before dark, 10 or 12 bats came down from under the bridge and went back up. And I was like,
that's it.
There's 2 hours of my life I can't get back.
That's it. And this, I said what everybody, because everybody was like, nobody was saying anything because they kept waiting. And I said, I don't believe it's going to happen. And this girl who we later met, who was 100% yuppie, she said, you didn't see them? I said, those 10 or 12 that came down? Yeah, I saw them. I just thought it would be a little. I was thinking Batman, you know, tens of thousands. I thought
at least as many bats as there were people, right? Yeah. I mean, that's what you kind of hear. But
so then when I got back up there, I was like, these people are so yuppified that thousands of people will gather on a bridge to watch 10 or 12 bats grab a mosquito. And they all felt good about it.
What a great night on the town.
I thought about bats. Phil when he's like, what's wrong with America? They're all crowded. I mean, this was the show? You come down here and I'll show you something
way better
than
that. That was a little bit of a downer. All right, so we're going to take another break, and then we want to have a real singer on the Unashamed Pipe. And we've all sang at different times, like O Canada, and different dad sings this little CCR every once in a while. But we got a real singer here. So
we'll see.
We're not singers.
All right. Let's take a break. So one of the things that has happened now, kids are going back to school, but maybe some are, some aren't. You know, you got certain states, they're like, don't let the kids go back. Other states are trying to get them. So they're kind of caught in the balance of this, and our good friends at Patriot Mobile are realizing this, and so they're going to have a special school days promotion. So if you go up until September the 12th, you can choose either a free phone or a free month of service if you switch to America's only conservative cell phone carrier, Patriot Mobile. And one of the things they're going to do is also donate a portion to people that switch over to them, to Students for Life, which is a fantastic pro-life student.
So there's no filth on this.
No, these guys are good. This is just your cell phone carrier, but these guys are very supportive of the same things that we are, and that's why we like them. So if you want to try these guys out, it's 972-PATRIOT. You can call them, 972-PATRIOT, or you can visit patriotmobile.com/Phil. If you use the promo code Phil, you get a free month of service or a free phone. So there's an opportunity if you do that. So you got two ways to save some money. Veterans and first responders save even more. And we love that, too. So 972-PATRIOT or patriotmobile.com/Phil. Use the promo code Phil. All right, Rhett.
Oh, he's going to sing?
He's going to sing.
I want to sing. Well,
what? Yeah.
All right, what are we singing?
This is our first time to have a musical guest on the Unashamed Podcast, Rhett Walker.
I'll play a new one. This is a song I wrote a year and a half ago. And you can't plan for the state of the world and what it is, but I wrote this song because, man, about 2016-17, I became the cynical kind of butt that I said I was never going to be. I was going to be thankful. Whatever God gave me, thankful. Well, you know, then you get to going through life, and if a radio single don't work, it's the radio person's fault, or if show didn't work, I would blame it on booking and. So I got off the road, and what I realized was I don't think I stewarded, like, the vision and dream that God had placed on my life that well. And I was just tired. I was exhausted. So I stepped out and got to go to church with my family, got to coach my kids softball and baseball and football teams, and just really stepped back, man, and sitting listening to those sermons and listening to those, like, corporate worship songs in church, it reminded me, this is why I do what I do. Like, I want to sing about peace, joy, love, happiness. Like, I know the sustaining kind only comes from Jesus.
Right.
Okay. And so, man, I didn't know if I'd messed it up. Like, I was, you know, off the road. I was like, maybe you can't disappear for too long, you know. Yeah. And people forget about you real quick. So I started writing this stuff, man, and I went to go write a song with a buddy of mine, and he was like, man, you stepped out of the industry. Like, what are you writing for now? I said, man, I don't know. I said, but one thing that I can say from being babies having babies, playing arenas, getting out of music, all the different things, the good times and the bad times, like all God has ever been is good. He's been constant and faithful. He's proven. He's able. And so I wrote this song, and then 2020 hit. And I was like, man, now I got to live out these songs. Yeah. That, you know, the proof's in the pudding.
That's right.
with with our genre of music, like, if do you sing these songs because radio is going to play it, or because you get to travel, or do you sing these songs because you 100% believe it? And so this year has been the hardest year to live out a song that I wrote, but I'm doing my best and trying not to become the cynical butt again. But man, honestly, even in this year, God's been good, you know. So this is called Good to Me.
When it all don't go the way I planned, when I work so hard for what I still don't have, when my best is just not good enough, the clouds turn dark and gray, I know you've always made a way. So I will look this storm in the eye, I won't fear, for you're on my side. My first hope, my last word, now and forever. Let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. All you've ever been is good to me. At my very worst, you showed me love. When I turn my back, don't give up. Yeah, you meet my needs. You always have. Steady and strong through the good and the bad. I will look this storm in the eye. My first hope, my last word, now and forever. Let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. All you've ever been is good to me. Oh, constant and faithful, proven and able. You're all. I will look this storm in the eye. I won't fear, for you're on my side. My first hope, my last word, now and forever. Let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. Oh, let it rain, let it pour, I will sing. All you've ever been is good to me.
That was good, Rhett.
Now, see, Phil, what you've been missing?
Yeah,
that was awesome.
Let's take one last break. So, Jep, tell us what you got going with Rhett, because you got some pretty cool stuff going.
We're doing a live virtual concert on September 30th for All God's Children, and thanks to y'all and my boy Blake, we have a $25,000 match already ready. So
awesome!
Our goal was to get that much more. So
yeah. So check it out. So what, Facebook Live?
Live.
On All Guys Children's Facebook page, right?
Yep.
Is that where you'll see it?
Yep.
Are y'all going to put up a little caption?
Yeah, we'll get Cole to take care of that. That's awesome. So everything that's raised, we already got a match because of the family and some others, which is perfect.
So we're so excited about it. And Rhett, I mean, obviously he's super talented.
We just proved that. And so where can they, like, find your music, and then tell us about your podcast too, because
you
got a podcast.
And you have a new album.
I do have a new album, and it's called Good to Me. And man, you know, I wrote this
that
record.
That is a perfect song for right now. You're so right. I mean, not just for you, you described it, but for everybody.
I mean, I think it's, you know, I was talking to a lot of people at the beginning of this thing. They, you know, it was like, hey, let's push everything back to June. Let's push everything back to September. Let's push everything back to 2040. Like, it was just constantly.
you know, and traveling, like that's what we do. That's mm-hmm. embedded in us mm-hmm. to like go perform and connect with people. And so I've just tried to keep my head up as a father of four. You know, my teenage daughter immediately was like, my summer's ruined. I'm like, baby, everybody's summer's ruined. So
we're going to heaven.
Yeah, it's a pandemic. Exactly. Yeah. But, you know, thinking back on just every walk of life, like with my dad being a pastor and doing the parking lot church, just everybody's been put out, you know. Yeah. So being able to focus on the goodness of God, I think, is been the only thing that's really kept me going in this. You know, because it's easy to complain. And I also think, you know, it's okay to get worried. Like, he's our heavenly father. He's looking at us as his kids. Like, it's okay to be worried, but we don't live in fear. And so that was kind of the weird thing is that was kind of the whole thing of this new record. It was like, man, we don't live in fear. And so many times we do ourselves a disservice, I believe. We focus on the depravity and we focus on, which we got to, and we focus on the mess ups and the hard times, but we don't focus on the goodness.
Yeah.
Like there's joy, even in 2020, there's joy to be found.
That's right. I've seen more fear
yeah.
in human beings in America in the last 4 months since February than I've ever seen.
In your whole mm-hmm. life?
Yeah. My whole life, I've never seen people this scared. Yeah. Walking around trying to think of who's breathing on you, or somebody yeah. coughs and you shot over their head. I mean,
don't sneeze in public now.
Yeah. Oh, but I think for us who are in Jesus, I mean, because even like Rhett, I mean, he come out here, admitted your failures.
Yeah.
You made it known to everyone your love for Jesus. And then even when you sang, that's what I like about your music. It's like you turn your heart inside out yeah. and sing with passion. And you were humble about your singing. But to me, I'm like, if this is not what we need
oh, yeah.
in our society right that's now. Right. But tell us where they can.
By the way, Jase,
where they can order that.
Yeah.
While you're on that, old Neil Cavuto, when I did a little session with him, you know, he was trying to figure out. He said, "How come all you Bible thumpers, you elect a man, a sinful guy like Donald Trump?" I said, "Neil, we're all sinful." I said, yeah. "Trump's just one of us." I said, "I bet you old Neil Cavuto might have a few sins. What do you think, Neil?" He said, "You talking to me?" I said, "Yeah, I'm talking to you. You got a few sins that you want to discuss here today?" And he said, "It's getting hot in here."
Yeah. Well, now you can get it wherever. You know, iTunes, Amazon, RhettWalker.com. Mostly I stay on Instagram. I'm not a fan of social media, but that's the one place I can kind of.
Yeah. Yeah.
So everything at
I've
Red
never
Walker.
Been there. So what's it like when you do get
it's Rhett, a dumpster fire.
I want to share.
Maybe
this.
That's why I've never been on there.
I want to share this. Jep and I were coming up yesterday, and we stopped at a store. We were trying to figure out where we were going to go, and this girl came out. She had a fast food get up on, you know. So I figure she's works at I forgot what
Whataburger.
Whataburger or whatever.
It's big in Texas.
Well, she walked by, and Jep's on the phone outside the truck because he was having some intestinal discomfort. But anyway, that's another story. And she said,
thanks for throwing that in there, Jep.
So she comes by and says, "Hey, how you doing?" Well, most people don't speak to me, you know, because if they don't know who I am, I'm the last person.
Yeah. They're assuming the worst.
And I went, "Hey," kept walking. And so she come back out later and looked a little rough around the edges, had some tattoos and, you know, and she came back again and I said, "Hey," and she went, "Jase." I went, "Yep." And Jep saw that she immediately just burst into tears. And wow. I mean, not just like got teary eyed. She started wailing. So I thought, well, here we go. I said, "I don't know what's happening." So I got out, and I said, "What's wrong?" And she said, "I prayed yesterday that God would give me a sign, and here you are." She said, "I've been," and I said, "No, hang on now." And she said, "No, I've been struggling with addiction," and she said, "I'm trying to get my life right." And she said, "I listened to y'all's podcast," and she said, "This whole thing started when your dad said that prayer at the end of y'all's silly show." And she said, "I just thought, what am I doing?" And she said, "With everything that's going on this year," basically what you described. Yep. She's like, "I thought I have got to get to Jesus and get my life straight. And she said, and yesterday I was thinking, just give me a sign. Well, about this time, I guess her, you know, what's the sponsor and her husband was coming up to see her. And then I thought, now this is just getting weird.
We're about to break out with some.
And she
some
said,
kind
"Well,
of
I told you." She's like, "Quit looking for signs. You got Jesus," which was a great thing to say.
It. Yes.
And then I said, "You know what?" I said, "Sometimes in life, you recognize that God set up a meeting here,
a divine appointment.
So here we are." And so as soon as I said, "Here we are," well, I heard a scream. Well, African-American girl she works with, she said, "Well, hang on. I'm your number one black fan." And she just ran at me wide open and jumped. And I you know, I gave her a hug, and I was like, "Hey, all right, we're talking about Jesus." She said, "All right." And then another fella, a coworker,
day before yesterday, Jase.
And look, so I just to finish, we just had a moment. I went through the gospel. I wrote it down, and I said, "I want you to keep this." I had Jesus in the diagram, and I said, the person who shared that with my dad, I said, he's with the Lord now. I said, but I want to leave you with this, because this is your direction. But so a lot of times, to go with what Rhett's saying, you don't really think you're making a difference. You know, you're singing about Jesus, and God is good, and we're talking about Jesus on a podcast. There's people listening, and the power is in who we have surrendered to, which is Jesus. And we saw it firsthand. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, I pulled up to the gate day before yesterday. There was a guy standing there. When I pulled up, our eyes locked on each other. Of course, I had my hand on my AR-15, and I said, "So what you got?" He said, "Don't shoot me, Mr. Robertson." He said, "I'm a Christian." I said, "I'm not going to shoot you." I said, "But I just wonder what you're doing here." He said, "I've been waiting for you to drive by."
He almost knew your hand was on the weapon.
Yeah. I was being edgy because I didn't know what he wanted. I said, "Where are you from?" He said, "Seattle, Washington." Wow. I said, "Seattle, Washington." I said, "There's a lot of mischief going on up in there." He said, "Oh, yes, sir." He said, "It's just a relief to get out of there." So he got his sister on the phone, and you know how they do it with them cell phones.
They do it with those cell phones.
He said, "You care if I run this on?" I don't care what you do with it.
I know we're out of time, but I wanted to finish with something Rhett mentioned, because it's not cliche. You know, Hebrews 12 says, "Since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." And the reason we can know, we can rest, and we know it's going to be okay is because Jesus has paved the way for
it. You betcha.
So we need more information, allgodschildren.org. So give you all the stuff you need. September 30th.
Yes.
Is there a time?
I don't know exact time.
Go to the website, you get the time. Rhett, you're always welcome to come back.
Thanks, man.
And sing. And Jep,
great job,
of course,
man.
It's good to have you back.
Blood.
Hey, I'm going to bring you all my podcast.
Yeah, what's your podcast?
Front Porch Gospel.
There you go.
But it's just going to be, we're just going to do the same thing.
Oh, let's do it.
Okay. Like, y'all are still going to ask me questions.
Yeah.
Because I run out of questions real quick on that show.
Thanks for listening to the Unashamed podcast. Help us out by rating us on iTunes. And don't miss an episode by subscribing on YouTube. And be sure to click that little bell to get notified about new episodes. And for even more content that you won't get anywhere else, subscribe to Blaze TV at blazetv.com/unashamed.